does Western democracy work in Africa? Essentially, do we have a different version of democracy for Africans? Is democracy a universal concept?
Well, first of all, obviously, when you look at his question, it implies that there are different types of democracies. But as you rightly said, are there really different types of democracies? Mm. No. I honestly think that democracy is democracy. You have to look at the universal tenets that make up what democracy is or is not. For example, the issue of accountability. Does it necessarily really have to be limited to Europeans
Westerners? Right.
Does it necessarily have to be limited to some kind of geographical locations? Talking about justice, socio-economic, political justice, is it something human? Is it something universal? Or is it something that is geographically or racially limited to some parts of this planet Earth?
Right. Basically, is justice in the West different from justice in Africa?
Precisely.
Right.
And what about the issue of fairness? Fairness. I mean, these are all these tendencies that I have mentioned, Jackson.
Mm. That are universal.
That are
essentially universal.
And also, in fact, that were actually practiced in some communities across Africa before the issue of colonialism.
Right.
Up to now, there are neighborhoods in some African countries, traditional African societies and what have you, where people respect the issue of accountability, the issue of fairness, the issue of integrity, the issue of justice.
Mm.
That in fact, when a man or woman reflects some of these tenets, it is more than money in the bank.
Even before Western democracy came into Africa,
we
practiced some form of democracy that very much mirrors what we see, what we call Western democracy.
As a matter of fact, across Africa, when you go to ordinary people, these are things, in fact, they practice, to be honest with you. The issue comes to the situation of people who actually hold and control what is called the state, the government. That is the issue.
Does the leadership on the continent understand democracy in those terms? Because we've had people say on the continent, some of the leaders say, you know, leave us alone, leave our affairs to us, leave the affairs of Africans to Africans, and you do your own thing and let us do our own thing.
It is very interesting. I wish they were right, and in fact, I wish they were even serious in the sense that they actually meant it, because when it comes to foreign aid, for example, they don't consider that as foreign interference. I mean, to be very honest with you, there are countries, I don't have to mention them, they pretty much, in fact, depend in terms of paying the salaries of their civil servants.
The national budget is
basically national security people and what have you. The budget is supplemented by who they call development partners.
Right.
But when development partners begin to invoke certain cultural and certain, you know, kind of like ideological, certain
principles.
Kind of
They're basically saying that, you know, if you're going to get money from us, if you're going to ask us for support, then you should respect human rights, for example.
Precisely.
And there's no question about that.
Yeah,
right.
And these are supposed to be universal values.
Right. Just exactly what you were saying earlier.
Precisely.
Yes. Right.
Then that becomes an issue. Then they start complaining, saying that this is foreign interference. So why don't you also, in fact, refuse to accept foreign interference in the form
of foreign aid?
Foreign aid.
Right. Return to sender.
But at the end of the day, when you think about it, it seems to me that Bobi Wine has actually benefited enormously from the fact that the state, at least according to a lot of people that I have interacted with, feel that the state has actually gone after him in a manner that is very difficult to justify. So to the extent that he happens to be a young man, again, whose future, frankly, is ahead of him, while, in fact, the man who happens to be in charge of Uganda for the last 32 years, people will tell you his future is behind him. He has also, of course, you know, in a situation like this, in a way, he has probably contributed enormously to the fact that you do have a situation here where Bobi Wine is the beneficiary of what I would characterize as a hugely exaggerated political attention, not only in Uganda, by the way, but regionally. You're talking about Kenya. You're talking about, in fact, I was talking with someone in Harare yesterday, he was talking about the same thing. And even internationally, you have some groups in America, for example, who have rallied behind Bobi Wine's cause. You even have Africa's first recipient of the Nobel Prize in Literature, Professor Wole Soyinka of Nigeria, precisely, you know, saying, look, this man happens to be, whatever he is doing is within his constitutional rights, because this is not a man that is holding a gun. Whatever he's doing, frankly, is provided for in the Ugandan constitution. He's using his art, his music, as a means of social change, demanding for social change. And this is not really isolated to Bobi Wine. This seems to have drawn traction among the vast majority of Ugandans. Everybody, in fact, right now, from what I hear, in terms of what I read, who you talk with, they seem to think that when it comes to change, change should in fact have happened to Uganda yesterday, not today. A new phenomenon that is developing on the continent. But for the most part, you'll find that some of these people who are looking for third terms, most of them with a few exceptions, are people who shot their way to power with AK-47. And in the process, these people may have done a lot of things that they really feel uncomfortable about, and therefore they happen to be very insecure. People who suffer from huge political complex, psychological, and what have you, who feel that there is no life really after State House. And therefore, they have to make sure they do everything within their power, and without their power, to the extent that they actually transform themselves into a sort of presidential monarch, so that they can actually die in office, and then they can be buried. But then, unfortunately, we have some other examples which you probably would not have thought about a few years ago. We have, for example, in Ivory Coast, Alassane Ouattara. He has hinted that he actually is going to decide in the next 6 or 7 months whether or not he's actually going to be a candidate for president. Previously, there was a constitution in Ivory Coast that had term limits. Mm. He is in the second 5-year term, which would actually come to the end in 2 years' time. But this referendum that was conducted earlier gives him an opportunity, because it provides the constitutional window of an opportunity for him to disregard completely what he served under the previous constitution, so that he can actually begin on a new slate. Mm. But the good thing is, though, there are also some other players who are even doing very, very well. You look at Macky Sall from Senegal, for example. Yeah. He has actually reduced the presidency from 7 to 5. And the guy in Benin wants to actually come up with a constitutional amendment that would require a president to serve only one term, just like in Mexico. Mm.